Seems like we're finally getting consistent good news for PC building. Howdy, howdy guys, Ponchado here, and welcome to Monthly Builds for June of 2018. In these videos, I show you the parts I'd use for building gaming PCs at $500, $750, and $1,000 budgets. To keep up with new prices and components, I put up a new video every month, so be sure to subscribe to stay up to date. Before we get to the builds, let's look at some PC industry news. The big news right now is Computex, one of the biggest computer expos where basically every company that makes anything for computers goes to show off their latest stuff. BitPhoenix, Silverstone, ASUS, MSI, Thermaltake, Corsair, Antec, EVGA, HyperX are just a small handful of the companies represented there. One thing that stood out to me is Philips, the company that makes monitors and light bulbs, is entering the gaming peripherals market with a handful of mechanical keyboards. ViewSonic, another monitor company, is also getting into gaming with a series of mechanical and membrane keyboards along with a couple mice. I'm not sure how they expect to turn a profit in this sector considering practically every company out there already produces quote-unquote gaming keyboards and mice, but I suppose at the end of the day, more competition means better parts for us. This one isn't so much hardware, but it is still a pretty big deal. Microsoft is set to acquire GitHub for $7.5 billion. If you're not into programming, you've probably never heard of GitHub, but the gist is it's a website that hosts a software development platform, which makes it easy for multiple developers to work on a single project, track changes, leave comments, that sort of thing. It's, as far as I'm aware, the single largest platform for open source software projects. Microsoft doesn't exactly have a great track record with open source. Maybe they'll bring in a bunch of talent and resources to GitHub and continue to improve it. Then again, maybe they won't. I'm not holding my breath. As for gaming news, EA and DICE revealed Battlefield 5 set during World War II with a bunch of pre-rendered gameplay, including a robot lady with three hooks for a hand. Tight. Naturally, the gaming community reacted with complaints about how silly all the characters are and the pretty much total lack of historical accuracy, to which the press and developers responded, "Shut up, Nazi." Battlefield 5 is really bringing out the best in all of us. We don't have any technical details yet, but we can reasonably assume it'll be running DirectX 12 with improvements from Battlefield 1. It's set for release on October 19th of 2018 and is available for pre-order on Origin now. On a final note of gaming news, PUBG Corporation sued Epic Games, the publisher and developer of Fortnite, for copyright infringement. Of course, suing your competition is the best course of action when your game's popularity starts dropping like a rock due to still awful performance, impressively horrific netcode, and your insistence on dedicating resources to adding loot boxes instead of, I don't know, fixing your game. Not that I'm bitter about it or anything. All that's happened so far is filing of the court documents, so we'll see how this case goes. All I can say is, good luck, PUBG. If you run this lawsuit as incompetently as you've run your game, you're gonna need all the luck you can get. Now that we're all caught up, let's get to the builds. First up, the $500 build. For the CPU, I went with Intel's Pentium Gold G5400 for $67. It's a 2-core, 4-thread coffee-like processor running at 3.7 GHz on the LGA 1151 socket, almost identical to the hugely popular G4560, but with a 200 MHz clock increase. The reason I went with this instead of an entry-level Ryzen processor is that AMD simply doesn't have anything available in the sub-$100 range yet, at least not from a current generation. That's important because the G5400 leaves us just enough room in the budget for this graphics card, a GTX 1050 Ti, for $190. The 1050 Ti has been the go-to for budget to mid-range builds for almost 2 years now. It's a strong performer at 1080p, handling medium to high settings in pretty much every game, and because it only draws 75 watts, it doesn't require an external PCIe power connector. For the motherboard, I went with MSI's H310M Pro-VD for $57. It's not a very impressive board, which is exactly what we want since we're aiming for a tight budget. It only has two RAM slots and doesn't have an M.2 slot, but for a budget build like this, you wouldn't, or rather shouldn't, be spending the money to get four sticks of memory or an M.2 SSD. That money is better spent on a faster GPU or processor. For the memory, I picked the Ballistix Sport LT 2x4GB kit for $91. It runs at 2400 MHz, which is the fastest memory speed the G5400 supports, so there's no reason to spend extra money on anything faster than this. Storage goes to Western Digital's 1TB Blue Drive for $44. Hard drives remain king for cost-effective storage, and I don't expect that to change anytime soon. Power will come from EVGA's 450BT power supply for $25. It's 80 plus bronze rated, which is better than almost every other power supply in this price range, comes with a 3-year warranty, and most importantly, 450 watts is more than enough for a build like this. That'll give you plenty of headroom for a more powerful GPU or CPU down the road. Finally, for the case, I picked Rosewill's FBM-01 for $25. It's a pretty bare bones case, but the inside isn't cluttered and it comes with an 80mm exhaust fan and 120mm intake fan. Most cases this cheap only have an exhaust fan. Altogether, these parts come out to $499. For an entry-level gaming computer, this is a great starting point and a great way to learn how to build a PC. Click the links in the description to pick up these components for yourself. Now, if your budget allows for it, I definitely recommend looking at the next build. At $750, it's right at the price to performance sweet spot, and it'll give you just about the best bang for your buck you can get today. For the CPU, I went with AMD's Ryzen 5 2400G for $159. It's a 4-core, 8-thread processor running at a 3.6 GHz base clock with a 3.9 GHz boost clock and has decently powerful graphics built in, though we'll be using a dedicated graphics card. In addition to that, since it's a Ryzen processor, it's unlocked. You can overclock it out of the box. For the GPU, I went with NVIDIA's GTX 1060 3GB for $240. The 1060 3GB is a fantastic mid-range card that can easily handle 1080p gaming on Ultra and medium to high settings at 1440p. It does require an external PCIe power connector, but that does come with a pretty substantial increase in performance from the 1050 Ti. For the motherboard, I picked MSI's B350M PRO-VDH for $71. This board has the two biggest features I looked for future upgrades: 4 RAM slots and an M.2 slot for an SSD. Beyond that, since it has the B350 chipset, it'll allow you to overclock that Ryzen processor. For the memory, I picked Corsair's Vengeance 2x4GB kit for $115. This kit is rated for 3000 MHz, which is ideal since Ryzen processors are very dependent on memory speed. For the SSD, I went with ADATA's XPG SX6000 drive for $46. It's 128GB, which is big enough for a Windows 10 install plus a few programs, giving you that snappy boot time and great system responsiveness, and because it's an NVMe drive, it supports transfer speeds up to 1000 MB per second read and 800 MB per second write. Nothing to scoff at. For bulk storage, I picked Western Digital's 1TB blue drive for $44. It won't give you crazy fast game loading times like an SSD, but it also doesn't completely blow the budget. For the power supply, I went with EVGA's 500W1 for $35. It's 80 plus rated, comes with a 3-year warranty, and will give you plenty of headroom for upgrades in the future. Finally, the case I picked is the Cooler Master N200 for $40. There are several reasons this case has maintained its popularity for such a long time. The first is that it's highly functional. The inside isn't crowded, which makes swapping components or putting your build together relatively painless. The second is that it comes with great cooling out of the box. Two 120mm fans, one in the front and one in the back, are pre-installed, and the entire front is a highly breathable mesh. Finally, and this may just be my opinion, I think this case looks really good. It's not an obnoxious design, but it also isn't a totally boring, featureless black box. With everything together, this build comes out to exactly $750. If you're deciding between the $500 build and the $750 build, I definitely recommend going with this one. It'll give you substantially better performance out of the box, and it's a better foundation for future upgrades. Keep in mind, AMD plans to support the AM4 socket through at least 2019. Click the links in the description to pick up these parts for yourself. Finally, for those of you with a sizable budget for your next PC, here are my picks for a $1,000 build. For the CPU, I went with AMD's super strong Ryzen 5 2600 for $190. It's a 6-core, 12-thread processor with a 3.4 GHz base clock boosting up to 3.9, has a huge 16 MB of L3 cache, and like all Ryzen processors, it supports overclocking out of the box. I have a strong feeling this CPU is going to become the next i7-2600K in terms of longevity, but we'll find out for sure a few years from now. For the GPU, I went with NVIDIA's GTX 1060 6GB for $290. The 1060 6GB is basically the most powerful GPU worth considering for 1080p gaming. The next step up would be a 1070, which go for about $500 these days, and in my opinion, aren't worth the huge increase in price. As a side note, the 1060 6GB is actually a different GPU than the 1060 3GB, despite sharing the same name. In addition to having twice the memory, the graphics processor itself is actually faster. Moving on to the motherboard, I went with the Prime X370A from ASUS for $124. It's a full ATX board and comes with all the features you'd expect: 4 RAM slots, an M.2 slot, plenty of connectivity options on the rear I/O panel, and beefy heatsinks on the CPU VRM, perfect for overclocking the 2600. for the memory I want with Corsair's Vengeance 2x4GB kit for $115. Like in the $750 build, I picked this memory because it's rated for 3000MHz and Ryzen processors take advantage of all the memory speed they can get. For the SSD, I chose Corsair's Force MP500 for $80. It's a 120GB NVMe drive rated for up to 3000MB per second read and 2400MB per second write, a significant step up from SATA SSDs. Bulk storage goes to the Western Digital Blue 1TB drive for $44. At this budget, you may consider getting a 2TB drive for about $15 more if needed, but to keep it under budget, I picked the 1TB model. Power will come from the Seasonic Focus Plus 550FX for $80. This is an 80 plus gold rated power supply with modular cables and a feature I love. A button on the back enables fanless operation under low load. On top of that, this power supply comes with a huge 10-year warranty, probably longer than any other single component. Finally, for the case, I picked DEEPCOOLEARLKASE RGB for $70. This is a full ATX case with a tempered glass side panel, RGB LED strip, and extensive options for expanded cooling, up to 3 120mm fans in front and 2 on top, or up to a 360mm radiator in the front and 280mm radiator on top. It also has 2 3.5-inch drive bays and 4 2.5-inch bays. That's enough expandability to last well into future builds in this case. Altogether, these parts come out to $993. This build will provide incredible performance now and for quite some time into the future. It will also easily support more or faster components like an extra 8GB of memory or stronger GPU whenever you decide to upgrade. Click the links in the description to pick up these parts for yourself. So that's it for the June 2018 edition of Monthly Builds. If you're building a PC for the first time, welcome to the community and be sure to check out my build videos to see how it's done. If you're a veteran and just needed to catch up, I hope these recommendations helped you. If you want to get notified of new videos as soon as they're up, hit subscribe and click the bell icon to enable notifications. So guys, if you like this video, hit the like button. If you want to see more, hit subscribe. And if you have any questions on these builds or the news, leave them in the comments below. Thanks for watching, I hope I helped, and I'll see you in the next video.